Father, thank you this morning for your word. We just pray the time we can spend in it now for this next few minutes might have an impact in our hearts the way you designed it to, in Christ's name. Amen. When you turn to the book of Ephesians, you're looking at the pinnacle of Paul's revelation. The Apostle Paul was saved on the road to Damascus. He's our apostle, the apostle of the Gentiles, and he's given a series of information, new revelation. He says that his ministry is the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. And progressively over his ministry, he has more and more new information revealed to them. First off, it's stuff that completes the prophetic program, Calvary, the cross work, death and resurrection of Christ were prophesied events, but there were meanings attached to the cross work of Christ that were never known until Paul comes along and reveals them. 1 Corinthians 2, he says that if Satan had known, if the principles of this world had known what Paul's going to tell you about the cross work of Christ, they would have never crucified Christ. There was a meaning attached to these prophesied events that was kept secret, and Paul reveals it. And then beyond that, there's some things that God did through the cross work that nobody ever even dreamed about, the forming of the church, the body of Christ. And that information, as it's revealed, when you come to Ephesians, you've come to the summit. And that's recognized. Bible, if you read a book on Ephesians, a commentary on Ephesians, they'll start off by talking about that it's the Mount Everest. It's the summit of Bible revelation about the grace of God. And it's certainly that way, because it lays out the secret administration in which we live today. But when you come to the last two chapters of Ephesians, and this is where I want to get with to, this unparalleled revelation that Paul lays out, when you come to the last two chapters, he takes you out of these heavenly places and he puts you down into the nasty now and now. And in essence, he says, don't take all this heavenly truths, this high calling that you have in Christ Jesus, don't take that and let it distract you and disassociate you from life right now in the nasty now, because that information is designed by God to live where you are right now. It's not designed to make you so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. It's designed to be something that lives in you right now. Because you understand what your future is, eternal life doesn't begin when you die and go to be with the Lord. It begins the moment you trust Christ. The program is ours now, and what happens now is part of what's going to happen in the ages to come. That's why it says in verse 15, see then that you walk circumspectly. Now, he started this walk stuff back in chapter 4, verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of Jesus of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you're called. He wants you to have a walk that represents the calling that God's given you in heavenly places. 5:15, he says, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the times, because the days are evil. Wherefore, be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Paul wants you to understand, wants us to understand what God is doing today, what God's will is. God's will for your life is not the issue of where did he prearrange for you to be at 3 o'clock this afternoon. God's will for your life has to do with what God is doing. God's will is not you, it's him. What's God doing today? I've said it for 50 years, like 40 years anyway. Didn't know it early on. If you want to do God's will in your life, you want to be right in the center of where he wants you to be. Don't worry about you, worry about him. Don't think about you, think about him. What is he doing today? And if you'll go in the details of your life and do what he's doing, you know what you'll be doing? The will of God. It's that simple. And instead of looking for something, oh God, where did you prearrange for me to be? Lord, what are you doing today? The will of God, there's two issues. God, our Savior, would have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So the will of God for your life is, one, you need to be saved. Do you know for sure you have eternal life? Your sins are forgiven. You have a home in heaven when you die. Do you know for sure God wants you to be saved? Saved from sin, saved from hell, saved from the lake of fire, saved from the wages of sin, and come to the knowledge of the truth. Two things. If you're lost, he wants you to get saved. If you're saved, he wants you to get saved from the religious system and into the grace of God. He wants you to know what's happening, and that's what these books are for. And so when he says in verse 18, he's going to explain some things. And be not drunk with wine when it is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. The first issue is for you and I to have our life under the control of the Spirit of God. To be filled, to be controlled, to be saturated with the Spirit of God. And the way that works is it's through His Word. God works through His Word. People are so self-centered, narcissistic. They want my special situation, and you are in a special situation in your life probably today. But they think about my situation. I deserve God to speak to me directly. A dream, an impression, a sign. And what that means is that God's Word isn't sufficient for you. I need God to make me feel special, to know that He loves me by showing me. Listen, that means the cross isn't sufficient for you. God commended His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. If you need anything more than that to tell you about God's love, that means that isn't enough. God said it is. Faith would say, God's right. You see, when people want God to intervene in the life with a miraculous, God already intervened in human history in the most miraculous way you could anticipate. He took upon our humanity the miracle of the virgin birth, how God became flesh. People still argue about that. I had a guy just this past 2 weeks ago sent me a thing of a fella who doesn't, you know there are people out there that don't like me, okay? Everybody knows that? And this guy, he just yelling and screaming about me all the time. And I learned something about myself I didn't know. He said that Richard's dad was a Methodist preacher, and Richard went to a Methodist school, and that's why he's a liberal. Well, one, I didn't know I was a liberal. But I didn't know my dad. It was news to my dad that he was a Methodist preacher. My dad worked for 37 years at John Morrell Meat Packing Company, and before that he was in the Merchant Marines. That he was a Methodist preacher was big news to him. And that I went to a Methodist school is going to be real news to the Southern Baptist Convention, because the college I went to, Mobile College, was owned and operated and still is by the Southern Baptist Convention. So, you know, I was always kind of, it's interesting to find out things about yourself you didn't know. And so, you know, that kind of stuff. So, you know, but then the guy goes on to tell people about and I think people can tell everybody else what they do and what they don't do. Listen, get on with telling people what you know is right. The most miraculous thing that ever happened was that God took upon our humanity and became what Paul says in that passage in 1 Timothy, the man Christ Jesus, who gave Himself a ransom for us. He's the God-man. But if He didn't completely and totally share your humanity, He's no help to you. If He didn't completely and totally share God's deity, possess God's deity, He's no help to you. He's the God-man who gave Himself a ransom for you and for me. And God would have you to be saved and to know the truth, because that life of Jesus Christ is what He put you in His Son, and then He put His Son in you. And He wants you to have an understanding of that. He wants that truth to control your life, for your life to be under the control of the love and grace of God to you in Christ Jesus, where His thinking is more important to you than anything else. His attitude about it is more important to you than anything else. And when you come at life that way and you look at life that way and you say, Lord, in my life, I want what You think about this circumstance to be the most important thing, then you'll want to study God's Word to find it out. You won't be going to the closet and say, oh, God, hit me with some information. You'll open up the closet, get at the desk, turn your light on, get your Bible out, start looking. And when you want to study God's Word that way, teaching you to rightly divide it won't be a problem. You'll have an internal motivation to get it. Now, what he does in the rest of this chapter, from chapter 5, verse 18, down to chapter 6, verse 9, is he goes through, we've talked about this, four particular issues, four what I call institutions, just because that's the word in English that describes it the best, that God established back in Genesis for the orderly maintenance of human life. You know what I got to do, don't you? I got to sneeze. It'll go away by the time I get my handkerchief out. And you can be grateful that it went away. Keep it out in case it comes back. Oh. I can blow your toupee away when you don't have one. Be filled with the Spirit. Have your life controlled. When your life is controlled by the Spirit of God, three things happen. We've been talking about it. Verse 19, you're speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart to the Lord. There's an inner peace and tranquility, the peace of God. Giving thanks for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. There's that thankful heart of gratitude, that grace that motivates you through life. You've been listening to talk about that in the case of Charlotte and the others. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. That's that servant's heart, willing to serve others before you serve yourself. Then he starts talking about wives and husbands, verse 22 and verse 25. There's this hierarchy that we live in. There's marriage, then he's going to talk about children and fathers, family, then he's going to talk about servants and masters, he's going to talk about the culture that you live in. And you notice the progression. It starts with you, and the word controls you. Then it works into your marriage. Marriage is the next institution. It's the basic fundamental institution for the orderly maintenance of society. That's how you pass on tradition. That's how you pass on stability. That's how you develop a culture, marriage. Marriage then conveys into children. I love what a guy years ago wrote a book called Sloshing Toward Gomorrah. And he started out by saying that every generation, there is a new every year there's a new generation of savages born who have to be civilized by the institutions in the culture designed to do that, the home, the church, school. And that is a observation of social impact you need to take on. The way you produce an orderly society is the home, the church, and the education system. That's how you pass on knowledge. That's how you pass on traditions. That's how you pass on the wisdom from the past. Over and over, God would tell Israel, remember what you learned back there. Let your fathers, forefathers tell you what they learned when they went here and went there. They learn what works and what doesn't work. You don't have to redo it. Every 20 years or so, 25 years, you see all kinds of things come up in the culture. I've told you about recently the kid that asked me about the book of Judas. Like it was all like they just discovered it. I said, dude, I was in high school and college in the 60s and they were talking about that. That's nothing new. You just got a bunch of new, uninformed people that come along because they never heard about it. They don't have any institutional life memory. And so it comes, and about every 25 years, somebody prints another book and makes another $1 million, retires to Hawaii, and off of something that's been debunked 200 years ago. But because people don't know what's going on. When you watch the news on the television, and you see a newscaster and they're 25 years old, think to yourself, what do they remember? 10 years ago, they were 15. They couldn't even drive. They're just waking up to the fact they were in the world. They don't have any memory about most of the things you remember. That's why they don't have the ability to put things in context. Why do they have a 25-year-old? Because they're trying to get 25-year-olds to watch. That's why. They're trying to convey wisdom. They're trying to sell advertising so they can cash their $1 million check on the way to the bank. That's all that is. You convey tradition, you convey culture, marriage, family, works its way out into culture. That's how order is produced in the world. Now you remember what we talked about when we started this passage? I talked to you about the issue of chaos and order. 1 Corinthians 14, God is a God of order, not confusion. You remember that verse? No, look at 1 Corinthians 14. God is not the God of the author of confusion, verse 33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. God wants order, verse 40. Let all things be done decently and in order. God doesn't want confusion. He wants certainty. He wants you to have an understanding of what's going on, and that produces orderly life. The adversary wants to produce chaos. Come with me to Romans 13. In each institution, in your personal life, your own volition, in your marriage, if you're married, and if you are, in your family, and in the culture in which you live, the issue is always between chaos and order. In your own personal life, when your life is in disarray and disorder, that's the adversary's goal. God wants your life to be in control, to be controlled by His Word, not to be in functional disorder. Someone asked me, I get asked all the time as a pastor, what should I do when I don't know what to do? I just don't know what to do, Brother Rick. Well, yeah, you do. You're never in a case where you don't know what to do. Listen, when you don't know what to do, stop. Don't go do something boneheaded. When you don't know what to do, stop and go find out what to do. So when you don't know what to do, you do know what to do. Go find out what to do. Don't just run off willy-nilly. Stop. Go back to God's Word. Find out what God says about the circumstance I'm in, how to think about it, how to act in relationship to it. And you say, well, that'll take too long. Well, maybe it needs to. Maybe you need to slow down a little bit. But it would be smart to do what God says to do. You say, but Brother Rick, you don't understand. The rent's due. Well, that's a different issue, isn't it? How did you get where you couldn't pay the rent? You know, whatever the situation is. That's what you do. You figure out how to function the way God does. Romans 13, that was a commercial so you can get here. Romans 13, you start with your individual volition. That affects your family, and that'll work itself out in the culture that you live in. Romans 13 talks about government. Let every soul be subject to higher powers. This is an inner man issue. The issue here is not what the outward structure of government is. The issue is here's how the soul of a believer is designed to function no matter what the governmental structure is. You're to be subject unto higher power, the higher powers. That's what he says in Ephesians, to be subject one to another. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. God set up human government. Why did he do it? For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. And I read that so you notice that word, the. That's the definite article. He didn't say rulers are a terror to evil. He said there are terror to the evil. There is a specific evil that caused God to establish human government. You go back to Genesis 6, 7, 8, 9, when the flood took place, God brings Noah out from the ark, sits him in the earth, and institutes human government. So what caused the flood could never cause the same kind of condition in the earth. And what was the condition in the earth in Genesis 6 that produced the flood? The earth was filled with violence. Total disorder. Where'd it come from? The evil of man's heart. The thoughts and imaginations of man's heart were only evil continuously. And the evil that was there, the evil thoughts and imaginations and dreams, the Romans chapter 1 stuff where you don't like to retain God in your knowledge. And listen, I think about that verse this week. They don't like to retain God in their knowledge, so God gave them up. We live in a culture now that isn't just we don't like to retain God in our knowledge. We're literally in a situation where we don't dare retain God in our knowledge. The culture has come to the place where if you go into the public domain, you don't dare talk about the truth of God's Word. Why? Because somebody's going to come and want to smack you down with the government. You go to the school system. They took God out of the schools in the 60s. But today, they don't dare God to show up. Now, the law doesn't say that, but the attitude that comes. And you know, you get in certain situations and you wonder, well, should I say it or shouldn't I say it? I was at the airport the other day and waiting on someone to pick me up in another city. And I'm standing at the curb and there's a place about the size of that little section right over there. It says, smoking permitted here. Nowhere else can you smoke. Now, I'm not promoting smoking, okay? But that's, if you're going to be a smoker, you got to go find the place where it's permitted. Got big sign, no smoker within 50 feet of this door. And I'm thinking, well, it's less than 50 feet, but now you got permission here. Then you don't dare. The people I was with, we went over to a place and we're in a park. And I'm thinking, would you dare smoke out here or not? I don't know. Why? Because now you have to have permission to go somewhere to do it. And what would you do if you were a smoker? Well, quit. That'd be a good idea. Avoid the conflict. Same kind of thing with the Lord, you know. You say, well, do I dare talk here? Don't I dare? Is there a safe talk, safe God talk area? No. Our culture, the order that, the disorder that caused the violence that caused God to institute human government, that was the evil. If you come back with me to Isaiah 33, if you remember the thing in Isaiah 14 about Lucifer, it says he did weaken the nations. The way you weaken the nations is you change the laws and the times. You produce disorder out of what God has given as order. Isaiah 33, verse number 5. The Lord is exalted. Isaiah 33, 5. The Lord is exalted, for he dwelleth on high. He hath filled Zion with judgment and righteousness. And wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times and strength of salvation. The fear of the Lord is his treasure. Notice what it is that produces stability and salvation in a culture. It's wisdom and knowledge. The wisdom of God's will. The knowledge of God's will. That's why Romans 13 says, let every soul. It's the amount of sound doctrine in the hearts of people that cause a culture to function the way God intended it to function. A lot of cultures don't function the way God intended it. But if you want to have the stability God intends for it to be in the culture, that's where it comes from. But you build that society up from the ground up. It starts with you. Matriculates out into your family. And then out into the world. What did he tell Adam and Eve? Be fruitful. Now, by the way, they were married before he told them that. Be fruitful and multiply. That is, produce a culture. Be fruitful. Have kids. Have your kids have kids. And that will produce a culture where you pass down what you've learned. And that produces a society. And that gives you the ability to go out and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over it, develop it for the purpose for which God has placed there. Religion never gets that done. The things here in Ephesians 5, and I'm going to spend some time going through these, the things that wives, husbands, all that stuff start next time in detail. I taught this stuff several years ago and went through Colossians. There's some studies in the bookstore about that if you want to study this. I'm not going to repeat that information, but there's a bunch of stuff here I want to talk about in this passage in a little different kind of light. But religion will never produce what's here. You know, religion's interesting. It's never correct. But it always has its own ideas. How to be filled with the Spirit. You talk about religion, they give you all kind of stuff. When you think about religion, think about Genesis chapter 3, Operation Fig Leaf. I think about this all the time, you know. Adam and Eve, what did they do? They went out and made them aprons out of fig leaves. Now, I think about that. Why would that be a solution? I mean, fig leaves? Why a fig tree? Well, there are four trees in the garden that represent the nation Israel, four of them. One of them's a fig tree. In Judges chapter number 9, when he talks about that fig tree, those four trees that God uses to represent the nation Israel, he says about that fig tree in Judges chapter 9 that when the fig talks, it talks about his sweetness and the good fruit of the fig tree. I'll produce some good fruit. I'll make life sweet. Isn't that what religion tells you? I'll give you some things to do you can please God with. But then it says, they made aprons out of fig leaves. Now, a leaf is a sign of life. It's the promise of fruit. That's why Jesus cursed the fig tree. It had the leaves, didn't have the fruit. But have you ever looked at a fig leaf? We used to have fig trees in the backyard. My house where I was raised, my mother used to go out every morning and pick figs off the trees. And she always wore those rubber gloves. You remember those rubber yellow gloves that would come up to your shoulder? She always wore those because if you pick figs with a bare arm, they'll eat you up. The leaves have little prickly things on the back of them. Now, I think about that. I'm going to make clothes out of fig. And you know what that is? Well, we're going to have some fruit. We're going to please God. But look, it can't be easy. That easy believism stuff. We got to have some skin in the game. We need to have some self-effort to resolve this. And it's going to have some irritable, harsh application. So that easy believism, forget that. Now you're going, what did Adam and Eve make? The Geneva Bible says they made breeches. Your Bible says they made aprons. You know why it says aprons instead of breeches? Because an apron doesn't cover as much. Think about that. They're going to try to cover up, but they can't cover up everything. Your religion never gets the job done, folks. And it says they made. You go down in Genesis 3, verse 21, and it says, God took Adam and Eve, and he clothed them, fully clothed them, with the skin of an animal. God shed the blood of an innocent animal and made a clothing to cover them. And God did that. You know what God did for you? Not religion. Not making it hard and irritable and distasteful to produce some kind of good fruit that really doesn't show up. But God took the Lord Jesus Christ at Calvary and shed his blood, shed his life for you. And when you trust him, the Bible says that he baptized us into Jesus Christ. That's not a water ceremony. That's God himself putting you into his, taking you out of Adam, putting you into Jesus Christ. And clothe you. You put on Christ. This morning, my wife put on twice. She came in, she says, how does that look? Looks good, chick. I saw that commercial. And she says, no, that doesn't look right. And I looked at it and I said, ain't touching that. Went back and changed it and came out. How does that look? That looks even better. First one, now do this one. Okay, that's what I thought. God put on some clothes, put you in some clothes. You put on the Christ. And you have a complete clothing. And according to Paul, the advanced will of God in Ephesians for you, for today, is going to manifest itself, first of all, in wives, husbands, children, fathers. You know what we call that? We call that domestic life, home life. Think about that. Domestic life is where God has moved up onto the front and center. And in the dispensation of grace in which we live, the focus of our current era is not on kingdom building, religious machinery and hierarchy building. It's not on going out and changing the governmental structure, the economic structure, the environmental rescue. The focus of the Word of God and the work of God today in a Spirit-filled life is going to be on your domestic life. I've struggled with that, thought about that. That's why I've told you years ago, one of my goals in ministry, based upon passages like this, was to pastor one church a long time. Thanks to you, I've done that. But the reason wasn't just to have longevity in one location because I didn't like to move. First 10 years of my wife and I's marriage, we moved 11 times. We're familiar with moving. But it was because I wanted to see God's Word work in a group of people and produce godly generations. And that's what this is talking about. It's talking about having God's Word work in you, then work out through life. You have your life under the control of the Spirit of God, in control of the Word of God, and you have that inner harmony and that thankful spirit and that servant heart. And then he says, wives. And a wife that is under the control of God's Word realizes that she's in a position and a job where she's created as a wife to be a helpmeet. And she develops that mindset and the habits and the way of life that the Scripture says, here's the role of a wife. Husbands, by the way, dudes, you're created to need a helpmeet. She wasn't created to need to be one, but you were created to need one. We'll study that in Genesis. And it's more than just a sexual relationship. You need a helpmeet emotionally and mentally and spiritually in order to be a well-rounded, thoughtful, balanced, motivated person, guys. Then you need to train up a child, children. Obey your parents. Not just put them in order and discipline, boss them, but to train them. Bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord to be strong in spirit and courageous and unbending in the face of adversity and temptation. So they don't jump ship when they become adults. It's there. And what that'll do is produce a culture of stability that advances the purpose that God placed you and man in the earth for. That's all what he's doing here. And I say to you all of that, the details of your life matter. The details of your life are strategically designed by God himself. Not that he's going out here and designed all the things that are happening, but he's designed that you live in the places that you live in a way that has meaning and purpose. His meaning, his purpose. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your cancer. Don't waste whatever's going on in your life right now. The difficulties, the joys. Don't sit around. Listen, we have a hope that one day we're going to be caught up and be with the Lord. Isn't that a wonderful thing to have? Bless God. What would you do without that? I watched Kyle sit there with his little daughter Thursday a week ago. They thought they were going to pull the plug on her. And in all the whole time that he struggled with, that he and Teresa have struggled and Gwendolyn have struggled with Charlotte's illness, the most peace I saw them have was when they thought they were going to lose her. Because they knew where she's going to go. And he told me the doctor doesn't understand, but it's okay if she gets to heaven 30 years before me, because I know I'll get there with her. I just don't want to see her suffer. What a hope to get you through. What would you do without that? But listen, don't sit around in your life, oh, I'm going to be raptured. Bless God, hallelujah. And worrying about that. I have people almost every week say, don't you think the rapture's going to be this week, Brother Rick? I don't know when it's going to be. And I know as much about the Bible as you do. If you could figure it out in the Word of God, I could figure it out. People say, well, you look at... Look. This is a training ground. The sufferings of this present time aren't worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. He says the outward man perishes, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For we look, while we look, not at the things that are seen. No, that's not what it says. I skipped the verse. 2 Corinthians 4. Don't believe a guy that can't remember the verses. 2 Corinthians 4:16, for which cause we faint not, that is for the glory of God, but though our outward man perisheth, the inward man is renewed day by day, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. And it doesn't feel light, and it doesn't feel momentarily, but when you look at it from God's perspective, it is. And what does that do? It works for us a far more exceeding and eternal way to glory. What you're going through now, as you matriculate through it, trusting God's word and doing it for God's glory, understand the outward man perishes, but the inward man is renewed day by day. You have God's word renewing your mind so you can function through these things. That works something for eternity. Don't fire your workers, folks. While we look. Not at the things that are seen, but at the things that are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Can I tell you the worst thing that could happen? Well, the best thing that could happen will only be temporary. But there are some eternal things that are taken care of already. But these present sufferings are simply working for us in a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. You're getting ready for something big to come, folks. Don't come up short in your experience for service out there in the age. This stuff's designed to work in you for God's glory. Charlotte was telling you about little Charlotte. Pastor up in Canada. This past week had heart surgery. Unexpected, had a heart attack. Not expecting it. Strong guy, never had any problems like this. Came right to death's door. They opened him up, found a problem with his heart they didn't know about, said if this hadn't happened, in 2 years you'd have been dead anyway of something else because of the problems you had. He was 10 hours on the table, supposed to be on there 3 hours. Serious deal. I'm communicating back and forth with him and so forth. Here's the email he sent me yesterday. Facing imminent mortality of this vessel certainly puts a new viewpoint on what I do with the rest of my time here. It's all about Christ. Saying that means more this moment than ever before. Such a privilege he extends to somebody like me. My suffering, though it is by far the most that I've ever endured, was so small compared to what he did for me. The more I ask, the more he gives, and I give so little. All of that means so much more than ever before right now. You know what that is? When you come to an extremity in life and you realize that the only thing you have is the Lord, what you learn is that the only thing you really need is the Lord. So if you go through things that bring you to the end of your resources, your hoard of abilities, say, thank you, Lord. because that's when his grace is there. Now that's what this passage is not going to be about arguing about husbands and wives telling each other what to do. That's what it's made into. It's not going to be about parents and kids trying to boss each other around. It's not about going out on the job and in the community and trying to tell everybody what they need to do. It's about having the life of Christ live in you. And what I'm trying to say to you as we introduce it is the details of your life, they all matter. And they matter for eternity. Don't fail to use them right now in the way God designed for them to be used. That's what it'll be about. So that you have in eternity that working in your inner man that gives you service out there for His glory. Now, if you never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, that's where it starts, because that's where the will of God starts. Doesn't start with joining a church. That's a bunch of stuff that can't, maybe shouldn't even come up. It has to do with being in the family of God, the body of Christ. And only God Himself can put you there. Romans chapter 1, it says that He was demonstrated, proven to be the Son of God by the resurrection. You know, God knows those that are His. One day He's going to resurrect us out of here, and only the saved go. And He knows He won't leave any of His behind. And it won't be based on what you did, it'll be based on what He did. And God this morning looks at your heart, right through all that other stuff, and He wants to see your heart, your faith, resting in His Son exclusively. And when He does that, that instant, you're His. And that lasts forever. So no matter if you've trusted Him, no matter where you've gone since then, no matter how little that's been reflected in your life, you're still His. And that's still life. Don't waste it. Trust Him if you never have it. And if you have, take it serious. Father, we thank You this morning for life in Christ Jesus, for the testimony of these that we've talked about today, to see it living in life, and for Your Word, to see that when it controls our life and brings the order and consistency to our thinking that Your Word's designed to do, that it works for Your glory, not just now, but for all eternity, in Christ's name.